My topic is the last but not the least. It's one of the important aspect of the of our armamentarium on uveitis in diagnosis. No financial disclosure. Biopsy pathology of uveitis can be of various types, anterior chamber, intraocular biopsy, or chorioretinal biopsy. And it can provide very valuable diagnostic information. This can be done by the anterior chamber tap, iris biopsy, vitreous biopsy, retinocoroidal biopsy. It's required in selected cases only. It's not all the cases you require pathologic study. But if you suspect infectious etiology where the diagnosis is not established by standard laboratory test, or lens-induced uveitis, parasitic infestation, endophthalmitis, muscular syndrome. Anterior chamber tap is a simple one. 8-year-old girl, I'm just going through example. Persistent hypopia and uveitis, not responding to the topical and systemic steroid. And here is the clinical picture. And you should rule out a muscular syndrome like retinoblastoma. Indeed, this patient on anterior chamber tap showed basophilic cohesive cells suggestive of retinoblastoma. This is a 14-year-old girl, history of fingernail injury, and you can see the granulomatous KPs and the total complicated cataract. What could be the etiology? You can do an anterior chamber tap, and it can show the macrophages with, engulfed lens matter, suggestive of lens-induced uveitis. Here you require only the lens aspiration. This is 7 days post-cataract surgery, and you can see that whitish exudative lesions in the anterior chamber. This you can see whether it's the lens matter or is the infectious agents. You should do an anterior chamber tap, and this an invasive test will provide the etiology. And here you can see the calcophore stain showed the fungal ball. So anterior chamber tap is required in IL-induced uveitis, infective uveitis, where the diagnosis is not cured by the non-invasive laboratory test, lens-induced uveitis, muscular syndrome like retinoblastoma, leukemia. The procedure is quite well established. There's an OPD procedure, 27 or 30 gauge needle, 1 cc tuberculin syringe, 0.1 to 0.5 ml of the fluid is taken. Culture should be done for infectious etiology, which is the gold standard, and the polymerase chain reaction. Aqueous humor polymerase chain reaction has been found to be quite safe, and it can alter the diagnosis in quite a significant percentage of the patient. How do you approach? Intraocular fluid can be done direct smear or cytospin. Cytospin is better, culture and polymerase chain reaction or flow cytometry. Culture is the gold standard, but it takes often long time. Often it's negative. For virus, it's not practical. It takes about a month time. Iris biopsy is required in selected cases where you can see the iris nodules or granuloma, which is not established by the standard laboratory technique. And here you can see a mass lesion in the iris, and you can see a synechia indicating that it could be an inflammatory etiology. Indeed, the iris aspiration biopsy showed, final aspiration biopsy showed KOH calcophore stain, fungal filaments. So where do you do the iris biopsy? Metastatic lesions of the iris and ciliary body, muscular syndrome, ruptured irises presenting as anterior uveitis, iris and ciliary nodule and granulomatous uveitis, where there is a sarcoidosis, tuberculosis, and fungal etiology is suspected and is not proven by the standard laboratory technique. Vitreous biopsy is often required in certain situations where, like infectious etiology, not responding to the maximum anti-inflammatory treatment, phaco-anaphylactic uveitis, and most important, primary intraocular lymphoma, where it could be a life-saving diagnosis. And here is the vitreous biopsy taken in the aspiration syringe is attached. And I'm just going to give you an example, 67-year-old female, dimness on the vision in the left eye 2 years. He had developed vitreous hemorrhage and underwent vitrectomy. Complain of dimness vision in the right eye. What could be the etiology? And you could see that in the left eye there is a subretinal infiltrate. And the vitreous biopsy was done, and vitreous biopsy showed clumps of tumor cells with hyperchromatic nuclei and cytoplasm, and you can see the bilobulated nucleus over here in the pleomorphic nucleus with segmenting. And cell block is better, and it showed the morphology of the cells with necrotic background. This is a diagnosis as a primary vitreoretinal lymphoma. One can find out infectious agents like toxoplasma gondii, Bradyrhus from the vitreous aspirate, if the astute ophthalmopathologist, looks at the slide. Final aspiration biopsy, it requires dexterity. Here is a 14-year-old girl, sudden dimness of vision for 1 week, and you can see the biopsy, subretinal abscess. Here we just put a fine needle one, that material was too small to make a cytologic diagnosis, but polymerase chain reaction showed mycobacterium tuberculosis DNA, and it established the diagnosis. And what has happened to the patient? After treatment, there is a complete resolution of inflammation with improvement of the vision. This is a 57-year-old lady, painless gradual dimness of vision 9 months, treated for tubercular choroiditis for 6 months. And here we did the final aspiration biopsy, and you can see that there is a necrotic background, and within the necrotic background, large lymphoma cells are seen. Retinal or choriretinal biopsy requires a dexterity and required in very selected cases. It is required or not responding to the treatment. Etiological diagnosis is not possible by non-invasive tests to differentiate infectious, malignant, and inflammatory conditions, particularly neoplastic lesion masqueraded syndrome. Here is an example of a retinal biopsy, and this was a courtesy by Dr. Narasingh Rao, and here is that retinochoroidal lesions. It was thought to be cytomegalovirus retinitis, but retinal biopsy showed a different thing. You can see that this is the choroid, this is the retina. There is a necrotic background, but you can see the Toxoplasma gondii cyst. Electron microscopy showed elegantly tachyoides. So choroidal biopsy in the diagnosis of intraocular lymphoma is quite established. Now coming to the molecular biology section, a few slides I'd like to show you. This is a cutting-edge diagnosis. Report is ready within 12 to 24 hours. Infectious cytology can be elegantly demonstrated. And here is the positive sample. Positive control should be positive, negative control should be negative, indicating high degree of sensitivity and specificity. I just going on example, 35-year-old female. He was treated with the oral steroids and intravitreal triamcinolone. Best criteria visual acuity counting finger 3 meters. And you can see the vitreous sails in one eye and exudates in the other eye. Diagnostic vitrectomy in the right eye was done, as does the vitreous hemorrhage. And what happened in that one, we could see the large clumps of lymphocytes, and here is the granuloma is seen, suspected of granulomatous pathology, TB or sarcoid. But to establish the diagnosis, we went ahead, did the PCR. PCR was positive for MPB64, I610, real-time PCR was 2,115 copies. And MPB64 and I610 region was positive. So next is the real-time PCR or quantitative PCR. It's a kind of a technique, progress of PCR reaction in real time. A fluorescent molecule, the fluorescent molecules showed cytopathology of polymerase chain reaction in tubercular intermediate uveitis. So this is a case of 42-year-old man developed cytomegalovirus anterior uveitis. Real-time PCR showed so copies of the fluorescent curve showed that the elevated copy number of the mycobacterium tuberculosis DNA. We did the publish this case, real-time polymerase chain reaction in recurrent cytomegalovirus anterior uveitis. This is a 32-year-old patient with history of encephalitis, and you have seen the necrotizing retinitis with separate lesion, and seminested PCR is positive, but what is very important is the fluorescent curve showing 88,874 copies. Polymerase chain reaction-based assays can be useful for the diagnosis of viral retinitis. What's new, this is the last slide, the lymphoid neoplasia, high frequency of MYD88 mutations is diagnostic of vitreoretinal lymphoma, which can be established from the vitreous fluid study. So clinical diagnosis in summary is quite important, I agree. Judicious use of non-invasive laboratory tests is essential. Intraocular biopsy is useful in diagnostic dilemma, in infectious, in muscular syndrome, in such selected cases. And now with the advent of PCR, with new armamentarium, reliable diagnostic tool in infectious uveitis. Thank you very much.